So my name is Machtelt Garrels. It is a German name, but my family has moved to Belgium since 5 generations or so. So come in, please close the door. I must apologize. My German is only house, garden and kitchen German. So I will do this in English. Some of you might have heard me at the OpenBSD stand. It's not so fluent in German. I'm going to tell you some stories about my experience. Do come in, close the door, please. We just started. I'm going to tell you some stories about my experience with governments. I've been working with free software for the past 15 years now. I worked at a lot of ministries of the Flemish community in Belgium. I worked for the federal government. And now I'm dealing with the Dutch a lot, with the Ministry of Economics, the tax department, the patent office of all places. What else? The city of Amsterdam and so on. And I help them to migrate to free software. And that's what I'm going to tell about. It's nothing very technical because this is the last talk. We will keep things easy and smooth. So I hope that you have all switched off your cell phones and so on. If you want, this presentation is under free license. You can just send me an email and I can send it back to you. I will probably publish it somewhere, but I don't know where yet. So just let me know if you want a copy. First of all, I'm going to start by telling some history, explaining some history about the struggle for free software in the Netherlands. It started in November 2002 with a motion that was put forward in Parliament by a guy named Mr. Vendrik. That's why it's called the Vendrik motion. And it said basically, look at all the software that we are using here in the government administrations. It's a shame that we are so dependent on parties that you all know, but that should not be named. Let's do something about it. Everybody agreed that it was a scandal and that the government should be more free, should be the owner of their data, should have the possibility to access their data and so on. So everybody voted in favor of this motion. Something should be done. But 2 years later, a little bit more than 2 years later, there was a document that leaked. And in the document, it became clear that Microsoft had invited some ministers and they had offered a good dinner and some drinks and so on, and maybe some extra benefits if they decided in favor for a Microsoft solution for new software that need to be bought. So there was no trace of the motion and all the things that everybody agreed upon. It was just thrown away. At the same time, in Belgium, you know, in Belgium we have several layers of government. You all know our do come in, please close the door. You all know that we have this Mr. Le Terme, the Prime Minister. It's been a disaster. He could not create a federal government. Apart from that, we also have the Flemish government, which is doing really well, the Brussels government, the Walloon government, the government for the German-speaking community, and so on. People don't talk about those because usually everything goes well. But the federal government deals with some important ministries, like, come in. Like, for instance, social security, the taxes, of course, which is always a dispute between the Flemish people, the Walloon people, and the Germans and the Brussels people. They also deal with justice and a couple of smaller ministries. And of course, data need to be exchanged between different ministries. And this became more and more a problem, as one ministry was, for instance, on the level of documents, was standardized on Windows 95. The next government was standardized on Lotus 1-2-3. The next used WordPerfect still. And so there was this group called FedICT, the Federal ICT Service, which was called into life to deal with this situation and to streamline how governments, how ministries should exchange data. In 2003, there was a rather informal discussion between members of FedICT. And they said, wouldn't it be nice if we try to standardize on open standards and so get rid of this vendor lock-in what we are constantly facing. And they created a nice document, and they did a lot of paperwork, and then they presented it to the Council of Ministers, who said, okay, this is a good idea. We should have more interaction between the ministries, more interchange and interoperability of documents. And the ministers decided, okay, make a plan so that we can work towards a more open situation. And these people from the FedICT group, they started working on a plan, and their eye fell on OpenOffice. But in those days, we are talking about between 2001 and 2005, OpenOffice and the underlying ODF format was not standardized yet by ISO. But it was in the running. And so the FedICT group said, okay, this ODF, it seems like a good thing to get rid of. Do come in. Close the door, please. Close the door. Hi. Come in. Hi. It's okay. to make a long story short, FedIC decided ODF would be a good idea for us, but we will also give a chance to Microsoft Office, to become compliant. If they have their, what's it called again, OXML, and should it become a standard, then we will think about using it if it is backward compatible with what we have now. Do come in, close the door, please. So ODF got standardized by ISO. I know that this year OXML also got standardized, but still we standardize in Belgium on the federal government level. Mind you, there's a lot of work to do on the lower levels. We standardized on using ODF for document exchange, which was a huge step into the direction of using open standards. Come in. I'm going to lock this door, you know. I thought all these German people were so stepped and strict and always in time and so on. That's probably only what we get to hear in Belgium, I think. So, FedICT was working on this program to use open standards, and they concentrated on the desktop, because it was a very visible thing for everybody who works with the federal services. Everybody has a desktop, and so they picked out this ODF thingy. And we had many governments from other countries who came to visit FedICT and who saw, okay, these Belgians, small country, but they are doing big things. It was really unheard of. So, let's turn back to the Netherlands. After this scandal with the leaking of the deal between the ministers and Microsoft, there was a new round in Parliament where everybody agreed, yes, yes, it's a scandal and we are addicted and we should do something about it and this and that. But a couple of friends of mine and myself, we thought, if we are not going to exercise some real pressure and keep an eye on what is going on and which products are being ordered by the government, then nothing much is going to change. So we decided to start some sort of organization which is called OpenDoc Society. And OpenDoc, yeah, we are mainly focusing on ODF because we had that example in Belgium that the federal services were using ODF already at this time, because we started in the summer of 2007. We decided to play some games with the politicians. We had our official opening event in September 2007, and that was in the Netherlands. Because we thought, okay, we are first going to start up in the Netherlands, because there we have to do a lot more. Do come in, please close the door. Look at the video later on to catch up. Where was I? Yeah. So we invited at this opening event in the Netherlands the guys from FEDICT to tell about how we were doing things in Belgium. And of course, the Dutch, they are always looking down on us. We are the stupid Belgians. Huh? But then it was like, if they can do it, yeah, we are going to lose face here if we don't do the same. So we kept on exercising some pressure, and it really did not take long. Of course, in private, there were a lot of people sending emails to all the people in Parliament, to the different parties, to the left wing, the right wing, the central wing, and so on. And we said, hey, later on, October or something, this proposition is going to be discussed, and I, who have elected you, I would very much like you to vote in favor. And we dealt with different parties like that. We did not contact just the party that we voted for, but we had a lot of people who contacted every member of parliament. And so it was a very strange thing when this proposition got to be discussed. All the members of the parliament were already thinking, I have to vote in favor of this. And they all had a talk in which they wanted to convince the other members that it would be a good thing to vote in favor of open standards. So that was a first little victory in the Netherlands, which resulted, it was in November, by the way, in an action plan for the entire Dutch government. It is called NOIV, the Netherlands Open in Connection, V from Verbindung. And on a very general level, this plan said that there should be more interoperability. Come in, close the door, please. Have a seat. Yeah, you could have taken the photo yesterday or this morning or this afternoon. I've been here for 2 days. Now you come in and you interrupt my speak. Ali, have a seat. That should be. So in this plan, they said there should be more interoperability, less dependency. Hey, why don't you leave the door open? Seriously. And most of all, there were two important thingies. You can. Hey, you're not. Okay. So, one of the most important points in this plan was that if the government writes out a specification for software that they want to buy, if there is an open source alternative that does the same thing as a proprietary solution, then we should favor the open source alternative. Secondly, And this was after the example of the Belgians with the federal ICT service. They also said, yes, we need this ODF for document exchange. And everybody, all the government services, including all the municipalities and so on, and the social services, the hospitals, and I don't know what, we give them until the end of 2008 to voluntarily support this decision. You can see that nothing much is happening. We have to push everybody and really make sure by organizing workshops for all the public administrations that the people realize that if you don't do it now voluntarily, starting from next year, you will have to. So this is your chance to take your time and prepare and do it at ease. But starting from next year, there will be really be fines if you do not support the ODF format. This was a simple step. Now, luckily, my colleagues and I from OpenDoc Society, we know who has the pot of money to organize trainings for the governments. And we contacted those people and said, look, there's this new law that has been passed in Parliament. Why don't we organize workshops explicitly for all the different kinds of governments and adapt the workshops to the different groups of people? For instance, we had an introduction workshop. What is ODF? Why the hell do we need it? What is it going to change? Do we have to follow this hippie movement and switch all our administration to open source? Or what do they mean now with this action plan? We had really workshops taking only 2 hours explaining the main points of the action plan to the different government responsibles. Also very important, we invited a lot of people from abroad in these workshops, like, for instance, there's Florian, what's his name again? From München, I think, Bundeshauptstadt. We invited him for a workshop to explain how they moved to the Linux desktop. We invited people from das Auswärtige Amt to explain how they did comparisons between different office applications that support ODF. We invited people from Denmark, from Belgium, I mentioned already, really from all over the world. Even from Australia, we had a guy come over to explain how the Australian archiving service has moved to open standards in order to preserve data for eternity. And this was really something that was welcomed with open arms, because people saw, okay, there are other public services who are doing the same thing. We are not alone, we are not the first. And if necessary, we can get help from those people, because the people that we invited made it explicitly clear that, look, we are here to help. So, back to Belgium. The Federal Linux User Group was started. This was a tricky thing, because you cannot just have federal employees organizing themselves outside the government. You would be some sort of starting terrorist if you do that kind of thing. So they, at first they called themselves the FedLUG, the Federal Linux User Group, but it was too obviously connected with their workspace, the federal government. So later on they changed their name to OpenGov. And these were really people from inside the government, a lot of people also from the federal ICT service, and they joined this organization, but they did it in a special way. It's not really an official type of organizational structure, but they claim their right to assemble and to talk about things they want to. So it's an unofficial organization of official people. This is Belgium. You need a special mindset to understand all this, I guess. We played the same trick in Belgium. We also had an opening event for the OpenDoc Society. Meanwhile, remember, in November of the year in October of 2007, the Dutch government said, okay, we will also do this thingy with ODF. And then we had responsibles from the Dutch government coming over to Belgium to explain, hey, we can do it too, and better. Huh? Because, yeah, that's an important thing to understand. With all our levels of government in Belgium, it was only the federal government that moved to open standards. The Flemish government, for instance, yeah, they have money enough. They don't care if they have to pay for licenses. The situation is a little better in Wallonia, because there they don't have so much money, and they are more likely to switch to open source software. But there we had somebody to explain the action plan from the Netherlands, which is really applicable for all governments, not only a certain level. It goes down to really the municipalities, the local governments. So it's from the top down that this is applied. And we had that explained in Belgium. So, yeah, a lot of people had to make some explanations again. In the spring of 2008, we had Victor, the Flemish ICT organization for municipalities, who started to catch up and think, okay, if the federal government is using open standards and so on, we will soon have to follow, because we deal with the federal government. We also get money from the federal government, so it might be a good thing to start preparing. And one of the things they did was in June of this year, they organized a special open office day. We organized a couple of other events in cooperation with the OpenDoc Society. And there were a lot of people from the government, from the municipalities who were there. For instance, there was also, for instance, a lot of police departments who are now using Joomla as a CMS, for instance. Of course, the organizations that you see switching now, it is because internally they have IT people who are knowledgeable. And they see, okay, we can do this now. Finally, the time is right to start moving towards, in their eyes, a decent solution, and they take their chance. But this is only like, one third or so of all the different governmental organizations and municipalities that we have. There are a lot of people who do not have enough internal competence and who are still running behind thinking, what is it to me? I can do everything with Microsoft software because Microsoft lets us, but they don't think about the money, vendor lock-in and that kind of stuff. So there's still a lot to do, but we had also some victories at least. Do come in. Have a seat. What did we learn from all this? There's a couple of things that politicians want and that they don't want at any price. First of all, they don't want to stick out their head. They don't want to be the first to do something. They don't want to be alone. They want to be together with other politicians. And they don't want to look bad in public. So, if you want to do something, make sure that it will work. You cannot just come into some government organization and say, oh yes, we will do it this way, and you are a tech guy and you have some brilliant technical solution that nobody understands because they have to change their mindset completely. It will not work, deadlines will not be met, etc. And who will look bad? It's not the employees, it's the politicians who decided we should do something. This can be a minister, this can be a mayor of a city, this can be the head of police. All these people I put in the group politicians, public figures, and you have to make them look good. Also, politicians want to make other people look bad. This is something that became very clear with the scandal in the Netherlands, where it got leaked that they were still dealing with Microsoft. Yeah, the minister who made that decision to invite Microsoft over and to have dinner with the Microsoft guys, he was all over the newspapers, of course, and other politicians were stepping away from that. It's not us. We did not do that. We're the good ones. We want open source. We want open source. Huh? Yeah. It's the same thing. Like they want some protection, so to say. They want to be able to blame somebody if it does not work out after all. And most of all, politicians want to be re-elected. They like where they are. They want to come back. So, we have, from the things that I told here, some tips and tricks. First of all, if you come into an organization, say it's the Ministry of Economic Affairs, you have to find examples of the stuff that you want to do in other organizations that are doing the same thing. It's not enough to say, okay, I want to move Open Office into this organization, and we are talking still about the ministry, yeah? And Open Office is used in Germany, in Freiburg. Everybody has switched to Open Office. They will say, yes, but that's not the same thing than what we want to do because we are special, yeah? So you really need to try and find as hard as you can the most similar situations and talk about that, first of all, to the managers, and then most likely you will not have any problems to roll out the application of your choice. It's most important to convince the managers that they don't want to stick out their head. You have to tell them you're not the first, really. You can do it. You're a big guy. Huh? This is also a form of not being alone, and this is reflected by what we did with OpenDoc Society, invite over other people. It's not enough to tell to the managers of an organization that there are others. If you can, ask those others to come and share their experiences. This is really a killer movement. I'm working now with the patent office in the Netherlands. Still the patent office of all places. The patent office in the Netherlands is going to be the example of an entire administration moving to free software by the end of this year. It's not impossible, but I will have to think about it. You know, from The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. After 1 year, the computer says it's 42. It's not impossible, but I will have to think about it, yes. What we did is, for instance, we have to choose everything for these guys. A desktop operating system, a CMS, a CRM, an ERP, office suites, groupware, everything. We need to look what exists and what would be appropriate to install here. And the thing that was most convincing for these people was really, okay, we call the municipality of Vught, and we have there a guy who is really happy with the CMS that they are running there. And we just said, would you want to spend half an hour talking on the phone to this manager here that we want to convince? We will talk about it later, give you credit and so on. And of course, this guy says yes. And we just let these people talk about their good experience and maybe also about their bad experiences. But like that, people who are new to free software are less afraid. They are still very, very afraid, but it's a little bit less. There are other things that we can do to make them less afraid. And this is going back to the politicians. I said that we send a lot of letters to members of the parliament. In these letters, we had different highlights of the things that we wanted to explain. For the socialists, the communists, the green, and so on, we said, okay, we have to do something about this digital divide. It is not fair, for instance, that the schools tell students that they have to make a PowerPoint presentation. It is not called a PowerPoint presentation. It's called a presentation. Yeah? And you can use PDF for that. And you should not demand that students have this Microsoft Office suite at home. Because what do you want to do here? Do you want to encourage people to give money to a monopolist that has been convicted? Or do you want to encourage people to illegally copy software? It's a very important argument. It also works for the Greens and the Socialists in Belgium. So I expect that it would also work here in Germany. The important thing I want to say is also that you have to take action. For instance, my daughter is 13 years old. She is also in need of PowerPoint presentation software. And what you do then is you contact the teacher. No reaction. Teacher is busy, has to correct exams and so on. You contact the director, the manager of the school. At first, I did not directly contact the manager. Sorry, I'm a bit wrong. I contact the secretary's office of the school to ask, can you find me somebody who can answer to the question that I have here? Why does my daughter need a proprietary software package if she can do it with some normal software? No reaction. Then I thought, okay, let's raise hell. We have a website which lists the members of parliament per political party with their email addresses. It's a bit of work, but after a while you get the hang of this and you start to create templates and so on, and you start to create your own personal mailing lists and so on. The important thing that you need to know is these people are there in parliament because you elected them. You voted for them. This is the first thing that you put in the letter. Dear madam, dear sir, I voted for you and now I want you to do something for me. This is my problem. Don't stop there. Always ask, and this is some advice that I got from a German friend who is working for LPI, who also has children in school. And he says it's very important to always ask, this is my problem, what are you going to do about it? Because otherwise nothing happens. If you ask a reply from the chosen one in parliament, they will have to investigate. They will have to contact people of the appropriate working group. Maybe they will have to ask questions to the appropriate minister and so on. But they will have to take action. And that's a way to start the move internally. And then they get back with the answer to you and then you can react on that. But keep that in mind. If you talk to politicians, don't say you're bad. You say you're bad and I want you to become a better person. And how are you going to deal with this request? Do it or I will not vote for you next year. An argument that also works is, and this is more for the liberals and people who are independent and so on, the small and medium business delegates and so on. By using open source software, you support your local economy. I don't need to tell you about Sun Microsystems, IBM, Novell, Red Hat, you name it. Those are all American companies. I made a small calculation about the amount of money that we spent in Belgium to obtain small papers that say, yes, you are allowed to use this software, but in the end user license agreement it says, but you are not allowed to tell bad things about Microsoft, about I don't know what. Did you read the end user license agreement? You should. It's a very interesting lecture. If you get a blue screen of that, you should not write in Microsoft Word, I fucking got a blue screen of that and I hate it and Microsoft sucks. Because you are liable, because you said, yes, I agree, and Microsoft can sue you for that. Enjoy. But of course, you are not using Microsoft Office, I know. This is just a hypothetical case. So, back to the local economies and the calculation. In Belgium, this money that flows out of Belgium, out of the European Union, and flows to the United States, who are still having problem to get their economics balanced, by the way. All this money, if we could just invest it in our own local economies, you know, we have trouble with the lower part of the country. Well, it's not the lower part, of course. These people are equivalent to the Flemish people, but the Walloons in the south, they have, yeah, they are not so lucky as we are. They don't have intellectual property that they can export. They don't have any industries anymore because they long ago took out all the metal and the charcoal and so on out of the soil. If you could invest all the money that flows away for paying for stupid papers, if you could invest it in Wallonia, we would have a paradise to go on holiday in Belgium, locally. You don't have to go to the Dominican Republic or so. But this is not the way that you put it to your politicians, of course. Just say open source is good for local economies. The local companies will have a lot of work to do if we just give them a chance. For the Catholics, the two stones with the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not steal. We have these big advertisements in the cinemas that it is illegal to copy movies and so on and to copy music. It is as illegal to copy software. And yeah, you also know that half of the softwares are hacked and it's wares and the keys have been cracked and so on. Put that to the attention of the politicians. I'm nearly done. Also very important, use some humor if you are talking to people. This is from the opening event of the OpenDoc Society. These two guys are very famous in the Netherlands and also in Belgium. It's cartoon figures. And it says here, yeah, welcome to the opening event. One says, it's rather calm here, and the other says, you did not send the invitation only in ODF, did you? If you have a migration project and you have to motivate people, then make sure that you have some freebies that you can give away, a mug or a t-shirt or I don't know what. If people get the deadline, give them something to remember it. And this could be a good thing. Another thing that you could do is to say, if you get the deadline by that deadline, of course. If we do get the deadline in time, then your manager will come to work for 1 week with their hair painted green or something. If you can get somebody to motivate people, yeah, it's different things in different companies. You might also say, if we get this in time, it's pizza for everybody. Whatever works in your company, okay? Also very important for migrations, two free software. try the easy victories first. For instance, moving to ODF. There will be dead bodies falling out of the closet, but make sure that when you first start actually using the software, that 90% of the people are okay with it. The other 10% you can solve that later. If you have to move an entire IT infrastructure to free software, try the website first, for instance, and then maybe migrate email, and then migrate groupware, and so on. If you are using open source software, you will not get locked in. So what you choose is not so much important. Of course, it is very important. I know, I'm also a technical person. But it's not that important in the long run. You can always adapt the software to what you need. Say that you choose a certain content management system, and it is not completely compliant with your mail system to send newsletters to your users. You will find a fix for that. It's not so important, but work step by step. Also very important, use an explicit policy. If you are working with government organizations, you have a lot of sub-organizations. And one is dependent of the other. So make it very clear that if somebody gets behind, that the others will be affected by that, that you won't get the deadline. And it's because of you. And we will publish it in the newsletter that is sent with open source software so that everybody can read it, not only the secretaries of the managers. Make it clear that you work with a deadline, because otherwise nothing happens. And make sure that you have training. Well, if you say, okay, we are going to do this migration, for instance, the website of the Patent Office, we are going to have it online by the 24th of September. We invited people over for the official opening of the new website. This is a very stringent ID. By the 24th of September, it needs to be there. This is an explicit deadline. We cannot crawl out of it anymore. Because we invited all those people, we made it very clear to all the users, to all the webmasters and so on. We need to work together now, because otherwise we won't get the deadline and we will look bad. All of you will look bad. That's an explicit deadline.
What makes it special for open source software?
No. Yeah. But if you are working in the government, they tend to say, oh, but it's not important. This ministry will be here next year. We will fix it then. If it doesn't work today, it will work next week, and so on. You have to really change people's mindset. We are talking about government employees here.
Okay.
Yeah? okay, that was the key word. Good. While talking about government employees, they need training. If you move them to open office, and for us it is perfectly clear that we do not have to select the third item from the fourth menu and then the second submenu, we see, okay, we can do it this way. No, for them you have to write a manual. It used to be like this, but now you have to do that. It requires a special skill set. Don't laugh. People are very stupid. They sometimes have mind blocks. Think about dealing with your mothers. It's the same thing. They say, I cannot work with this computer, and it will not work. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy. Make sure that they are in the right mindset again. Make sure that they feel good. Make sure that you deal with their problems and not with what you think is fantastic in the software package. They have these problems that they have to deal with every day. The patent office again. They had a calendar in their Tridion CMS. And if you want to browse the calendar, you have to select the month every time. You have to say, I want to browse this month. This was an issue for them. So make sure that if you move to a new software, that you find out what the issues are with the old software, and that people can feel good about this movement towards new software because their problems will be solved. And deal with that. It's a very important advice that I can give you. I've done it a million times. People will have mind blocks. There will also be these people. You have a small subgroup of administration. Yeah. It's time for me to stop. I know. I'm nearly finished. You have like a sub-administration in the tax department. There are the people who deal with the taxes of, ship navigation, big containers. And it's a group of 20 people. You will always have one guy or one woman who is opposed to change. Most people are opposed to change, but on the other hand, they have seen so many migrations. They've moved from WordPerfect to Lotus 1-2-3 to Lotus 3-4-5 to Microsoft Office 95, 96, 97, etc. They're used to it. They go to their job every day and say, I don't care. Okay, we will do it like this. And they will follow you. But there will always be people who are opposed and who want to keep on doing their thing the old way. And they want, you will find people who are still using WordPerfect and that kind of thing. And you will find people who are using some obscure scripting language because they have learned that in the 70s and it still works by some strange coincidence because they could always protect their computer from being upgraded and they have a secret stash of reserve parts and so on. The things I've seen, don't laugh. You have to get these people you have to convince these people to follow you. You have to tell these people, look, it's not so bad, and we will have maybe a new or a different way of working. And it's really a game of psychology. Because if you have the group leader that everybody follows that old guy because he can solve all the little problems and so on, if you can get that guy to be with you on the migration project, and the others will follow as well. If that guy says, no, it's not good and we will not do it, then there will be a lot of people who say, yeah, but if he says it, yeah, then yeah, we won't do it either. Psychology. Okay, what else? I told about this. The way to work. Yeah, it's rather difficult, of course. We are talking about a lot of different software packages. In free software, there's a lot more choice. I don't need to tell you. For email servers alone, you could have like 25 different systems that are very reasonable. What we do is we make a long list of all available applications. And first of all, we look at the license. Is it really free software or do you have to get a license or register for, I don't know what, if you have 100 users or that kind of thing. So we go for the real free software, which is GPL, BSD license, and so on, Creative Commons without any restrictions, that kind of stuff. We look for software that is maintained. A good criterion is if there haven't been any updates during the last year, throw it away. It's not usable in government administration. Also in the long list, what is important for the managers of government administration is maturity of the software. If a software, it can be as good as anything, if it has a version number 0.1.8, it's not good. It should be 8.1.0. That's a really mature software. Yeah. Believe it or not, these are the tricks. That's for the long list. Then you make the short list. You look at the users who are going to have to use the software. You look at their requirements. You also let the managers list their requirements and so on, and no problem. Those can be dealt with. But then you have the more difficult requirements of users who want to publish a news article, and that must be published automatically in a list with new articles, and there should only be 3 new articles at any time, and they should rotate, and that kind of special request. It can be done. It's a simple script. It's nothing to worry about. You know it, but they don't know it, and you will have to fix it, and you will have to calculate in time for you writing code to fix those little problems. Yeah? People will have requests that are not in the standard specs. For instance, for the patent office, for deciding on a content management system, we take cmsmatrix.org. Don't always believe what is in these listings. They are often outdated. Like the case of WebGUI, which came on the shortlist. WebGUI, let me tell you something about WebGUI. The other two on the shortlist, you make a shortlist with 3 applications that you are going to install at the client side or at your company, and the clients can come in and test it. You make 3 applications. The other 2 applications were Drupal and Joomla. Drupal, Joomla, mature, stable, works, you can upgrade it. There's a road plan for them. They have large communities. You don't see many problems with them. WebGUI, on the other hand, I don't know how it came to be on the shortlist, but it's written in Perl. Like there was this drunken guy, and he said one evening, "You know what? I can write a CMS in Perl, and you know what? I'm going to prove it to you." You cannot upgrade it. You can only install it on one machine. It breaks all your existing databases. And the killer application, which is that you can move content blocks by drag and drop, well, they are not going to use it at the patent office, because we make the layout for them. They only have to provide content. So you, as a tech guy, might think that it is a fantastic thing to write a CMS in Perl, but you have to think about other people who have to use it, make adaptions if a bomb drops on you, about upgrade paths and so on, about high availability. I worked for the Belgian Railway Company. I created a new system for guiding. No, I did not create a new system. I helped migrating the old system for guiding the trains, the national dispatching, to a new software and hardware platform. We had several choices of platforms and of applications to run in there. Do not make mistakes. People don't like it when the trains start crashing. Okay? So it's the same for any other administration, even the patent office. It's not that their lives depend on it, but think before you act. Choose something that will give you reliability in the future as well. Choose something that has commercial support. WebGUI, in this case, there's nobody who wants to commercially support it, because you cannot get an insurance if things go wrong. Also, what was very important, during the testing of the CMS at the patent office, we ranged out WebGUI and we just did a setup with Drupal and Joomla. And in the end, people, the webmasters who were going to have to make the content and little changes and so on, they choose Joomla after all, even though they liked Drupal, but Drupal was too different from what they were used to. They needed to change their mind too much. They got the impression, oh, Joomla, I know this from my weblog at home. Immediately, that was a good point for the Joomla application. Just because of that, it was nearly not necessary to test Drupal and to try to understand the different ways in which Drupal worked. They looked at it, and there's a literal quote from the lady who said, okay, this looks like my weblog at home. She said, it looks nice. I want to start and spend time on this. I want to learn it. Yeah? You need the approval of the users who are going to do it in the end, the people on the work floor. This is what I mean by applications have to resemble the known universe. It makes them easier to get adopted. Well, if you have any questions, I think we have 5 minutes left before the final end of the FrOSCon. So be my guest.
Public administrations quite a lot of macros written
yes.
in Visual Basic or
yes.
something like this, which are very difficult to migrate
yes.
to an open source platform.
The thing is, you should migrate functionalities and not existing solutions for a problem.
Well, that's true, but the problem is that these macros written often also is the give the power of knowing something, and you dispower them. You just take the power away because they don't know how to do it with a new environment often. And
it's part of the training that you should replace this then with something what they like to do, and you should explain them how to use the new system. I've seen this, for instance, in many environments. We migrated to ODF, and you have to make the migration is not so much a problem than the indexing of what you have. What documents do you have? How do you use them? Where are the dead bodies? Where are the access databases that somebody wrote long ago to make a fix to some immediate problem, but they did not think about moving it? And that's why you still have that secret Windows 95 machine in the corner and so on. I know this is very difficult. And it's really a challenge. We looked into, for instance, the SUSE version of OpenOffice, because they have special support for migrating macros. But even then, you will have to analyze. If it does not work, you will have to analyze what do they want here and how are we going to do it now. Most of the things are not impossible. It's just a different way of working. And the people who wrote the macros, there are two types. Either they are long dead, because nowadays nobody uses macros, or they are really specialists, and those are the people that you have to find and get behind you, and then the others will follow. No, I'm exaggerating a bit. Macros, of course, are still used a lot. I recently did a workshop in Zagreb, in Croatia, and there was this guy who imported a macro from his workplace, which was rather difficult. And he wanted to see if it would still work in OpenOffice. He did not have to do anything, it just worked. That's also a possibility. Yes, yes, of course, but all things can happen. And it is most important that you make an index of what is needed and how are we going to deal with it. And this preparation work takes the most time. After you have analyzed your existing situation, it's peanuts to move to a different environment.
From my experience, you have often also in Word or in Excel, you have large written codes documented only by the person who wrote the code.
Yeah, and they work in another business now.
In the administration.
Yeah, yeah, and automatic filling in of forms and creation of forms and that kind of stuff. I've seen it. It's terrible. You either have to find those people or reverse engineer what it is that they want to do here.
Yeah, but they want it. They don't want to change. They want to keep their position. That's the problem. So
but you will have to exchange that with something else. Like, okay, we take away this from you. But things that work, for instance, is the font works in OpenOffice. And we take away this from you, but you get these nice font works. And people are happy as a child. It's Serious, it's all about psychology. I'm maybe simplifying things too much here, but you will have to really look at the psychology of a person and think, as a project manager, how am I going to convince this person? They have to follow. You can do it the hard way. Okay, if you don't follow, you're fired. But that's not nice for you as a manager, and it's not nice for the employee. Often you cannot do it because they are government employees. You cannot fire them. They're there for life. So, you will have to find some way to convince them, to give them little presents and so on. Also, what often works is to apply on the vanity of these people and say, you know this, why don't you explain it to me or to your colleague?
Okay, yeah. Change the rule.
Yes. Thanks for your attention. See you next year. I think I will tell something about SSH next year.